Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. The whole church needs to say thank you, Lord. Thank you. Oh, and ask yourself, where would I be this morning if you hadn't woke me up? Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Yes, yes, Lord. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Oh, thank you, Jesus. He's been good. Oh, thank you, Jesus. He's been so good. He's been good. Yes, he has.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Did he wake you up this morning? Let us give praise and honor to our God. He is worthy to be praised. He is our King of Kings. He is our Lord of Lords. Hallelujah. The splendor of the King. Rejoice, let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, and trembles at his voice.
Yeah.
is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. Hallelujah. 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 Every Sunday we just kind of sing like two praise and worship songs, but last night, yesterday evening, I went to this party. I went to this karaoke gathering here in church downstairs. And when I tell you that there was a song that was sung and everybody got up like, this is my jam. So we're gonna sing that together. We're not giving God a leftover praise. We're giving him a fresh new praise. So I want everybody to stand up. If you can, But stand up in your spirit. Because last night we sang Break Every Chain, didn't we? And we sang it like a prayer, didn't we? And so to everybody who is here, let's sing it together. Because there is power in the name of Jesus. He is the only power that we know. He is the only power that we rely on. Let us sing. There is power in the name of Jesus. Yes. There is power in the name of Jesus.
There is power in the name
thank you to break every chain, break every chain, break every chain, to break every chain, break every chain. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah.
Amen. Amen.
Grace and peace in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Good morning. Please join me in the call to worship. O God, answer us when we pray.
Listen to us and hear our prayers.
Remember that the Lord has chosen the righteous for his own.
He hears us when we call on him.
Please remain standing for the opening hymn 371. I stand amazed in the presence.
In the presence of Jesus and Nazarene.
Praise God.
Please be seated. Let us pray. Merciful and gracious God, I come before you this morning with a humble and contrite heart to praise and glorify your name because you are the great I am. You are the giver of life, and I say thank you for waking all of us up this morning to see and enjoy the beauty of your creation. We pray for peace in our church, peace in our communities within the United States, and peace in the world at large. We pray for the disenfranchised, the sick and shut in, especially those with mental illness and addictions. May you mend every broken heart, dear God. Touch all who need healing. Comfort and bless all who are burdened in anger and grief. A special prayer for Pastor Reverend Dr. Hugh Hamilton. Anoint him with your Holy Spirit as he brings the preached word to us today. May it touch all our hearts and minds so that we will leave here better than we came. Lord, fill this day with answered prayer. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. We'll have the acknowledgement of visitors by our pastor.
Grace and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord Jesus.
Grace and peace be unto you from God our Father and our Lord Jesus.
We are changing. It is a joy to be in the house of the Lord. I want to express a word of thanks for those leading us in praise and worship so far. And we want to express a word of thanks that you are here to join with us in this time of fellowship. Especially we want to welcome those who we are seeing for the first time, or perhaps for the first time in a long time. I'm going to ask you to stand and remain standing, please, because we're going to do a special song for you. So when I call your name, just remain standing that we can see you. Sean Thomas, please stand. Bless the Lord. Sean, it's great to have your grace. If you have a home church, take our greetings back to your church. But if not, we want you to know that we'd love to have you here. Bless the Lord. Merlin, I believe the middle name is Juno Charles. Merlin, Juno Charles. Merlin, it's great to have you. Welcome to Grace, and we look forward to having more of you here. We express the same sentiments to you. What about Jody Ann Burnbridge? Jody Ann, bless the Lord. Welcome, Jody Ann. Great to have you. We hope we'll see a lot more of you. And Jivan, did I get that name right? Jivan Burnbridge? That must be your son, Jivan Burnbridge. It's great to have you, sir, with us. And Janice Chernevsky? I hope I didn't do any violence to your name. Janice, it's great to have you. Please remain standing. And Victoria Reed. Victoria. Can you imagine how blessed our community will be and how much better looking we will be if all these people joined us?
Yes.
Boy, we should find a way to make that happen. But right now, we just want to welcome you to Grace and trust that you have a wonderful time today, and do come again. God bless you. Please stand and sing the Grace song for them.
Everybody's alive, captain, available.
Please be seated. We will now have our grace dancers of praise. Thank you, dancers of praise. We'll now have our Sunday school moment by Sister Simone Morris. Welcome the children.
Grace and peace. So good to see all of you out this morning. Amen. So this is the third Sunday of Easter, so we are still talking about the resurrection story. And last week I told you storytelling is a great way to keep history alive, because that's how we can recount events that happened in the past. Who remember the lesson that we started last week in Sunday school? Anyone remember? All right, so I'll tell you this little parable to jog your memory. So let's say you're walking down Murdoch Avenue, right? Picture it. You're walking down Murdoch Avenue and you come upon a stranger and you invite the stranger to church. You say, please come to Grace United Methodist Church. So then you started saying, we have a dynamic preacher, we have dynamic dancers of praise, we have great youth choir. So you're telling the stranger all about your church. And then the stranger says to you, we are growing, we are changing, and God is in your midst. And all of a sudden you realize this is not a stranger. Who is it? It's a Reverend Hamilton. All right. So our story last week was about the two disciples walking down the road to Emmaus and Jesus joined them, right? But they didn't recognize that it was Jesus. So they started recounting with Jesus everything that happened and they invited Jesus to come stay with them. But again, they didn't know that this was Jesus. But then Jesus did something that opened their eyes. Anyone remember what happened?
He gave them a piece of bread.
All right, she said he gave them a piece of bread. So he broke bread with them. And when he broke bread with them, their eyes were opened and they recognized that this was Jesus. All right, so I'm going to invite you to come with me to Sunday school so we can talk about another story that happened after the resurrection. Right, so everyone didn't believe that Jesus rose from the dead. So we're going to have a story today about someone who didn't believe. Amen.
Yeah, let's give it up for the children. They are certainly learning about Jesus. Today's scripture is the epistle, 1 John 3, verses 1 to 17. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that I did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be has not yet been revealed. What we do now is this. When he is revealed, we will be like him, for we see him as he is. And all who have this hope in him purify themselves just as he is pure. Everyone who commits sin is guilty of lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. You know that he was revealed to take away sins, and in him there is no sin. No one who abides in him sins. No one who sins has either seen him or known him. Little children, let no one deceive you. Everyone who does what is right is righteous, just as he is righteous. Everyone who commits sin is a child of the devil, for the devil has been shining from the beginning. The Son of God was revealed for this purpose, to destroy the works of the devil. Those who have been born of God do not sin, because God's seed abides in them. They cannot sin, because they have been born of God. The children of God and the children of the devil are revealed in this way. All who do not do what is right are not from God, nor are those who do not love their brothers and sisters. For this is the message you have heard from the beginning, that we should love one another. We must not be like Cain, who was from the evil one and murdered his brother. And why did he murder him? Because his own deeds were evil and his brother's righteous. Do not be astonished, brothers and sisters, that the world hates you. We know that we have passed from death to life because we love one another. Whoever does not love abides in death. All who hate a brother or sister are murderers, and you know that murderers do not have eternal life abiding in them. We know love by this, that he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for one another. How does God's love abide in anyone who has the world's goods and sees a brother or sister in need and yet refuses help? Here ended the reading of God's holy word. Please stand for the reading of the gospel by our pastor.
The gospel according to Luke chapter 24, from verse 36b to verse 48. While they were talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified and thought that they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I myself. Touch me and see. For a ghost does not have flesh and bones as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. While in their joy they were disbelieving and still wondering, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. And he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things." The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Please remain standing for our sermonic hymn, "Great is Thy Faithfulness."
Thank you.
Please be seated.
Amen. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord Jesus. So today we want to use as a subject for reflection the Christian's purifying hope. We're talking about purity, which is not a popular word these days. Who wants to be pure? People want to win. People want to be rich. People want to succeed. What are you talking about, pure? So we're going to use this unpopular subject, the Christian's purifying hope. And this subject is informed by the scripture found in 1 John. 1 John. 1 John chapter 3 and the first three verses. Just before we pause for a moment of prayer, let's just read those first three verses. 1 John chapter 3, the first three verses which inform this subject for today. You hear these words at funeral, but it's not about funeral, it's about living now. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know Him. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be has not yet been revealed. What we do know is this: when He is revealed, we will be like Him, for we shall see Him as He is. That's the hope there. All who have this hope in Him purify themselves just as He is pure. The word of God for the people of God. Let's pray. Speak, O God, to us in this time of reflection. Speak a message that is relevant to our lives. Speak a message that is specific to our situation. Take charge, O Lord, and let each word spoken have your divine unction, that in your power, in your risen grace, you will speak to each heart. In the name of Jesus, amen. Amen. The Christian's purifying hope. Yes, we're talking about purity. Do you find it difficult to be a Christian sometimes? No. Well, most of you silent, so you're having an easy time. That's good? Yes. You don't find it difficult, that's good. It doesn't mean everybody's finding it difficult. But for those who are presented with challenges, the question I want you to consider is, what keeps you going? What keeps you going? You don't have to answer this question out loud, but let me ask you this. Do you feel to give up sometimes? Do you feel like stop coming to church sometimes? And what keeps you motivated? I saw at least one person shaking their head. You know, ever feel like not coming to church? That's good, because that's how I want you to feel. I don't ever want you to feel like not coming to church. But what keeps you motivated? Do you find some other Christians hard to live with sometimes? Yes. Oh, Jesus, you look like you have a lot of grace here. Everybody say amen. They have other Christians that are hard to live with sometimes. The question is, what keeps you showing up for fellowship? What keeps you showing up for fellowship? Because in spite of all the hard to live with people, something moves you to put one foot in front of the other and come to grace every Sunday. And it's good if you find out what that is. I am sure that John the Apostle, the writer of 1 John 3, 1 to 3, had some of these feelings too. But I want to tell you, something inside him kept him going. And we can call it John's purifying hope, or we can call it the Christian's purifying hope, because it's the same thing that can keep us going as well. But something kept him going, and not just going, something kept him getting better at being a Christian. And I want to suggest to you today
that as hard as things must have been for John sometimes, he still lived for Christ through adversity and persecution, and he still called others to Christ-like living because of this something that was in him. What was this hope in him that kept him going? And what was this hope in him that kept him getting better? I mean, he had troubles, you know. I want to tell you something about the John who wrote this epistle. It's the same John who wrote the Gospel of John. There's no dispute about that. It's the same John who wrote the Revelation. So this guy had been through some stuff. He had been through persecution. He had known hard times. He had known suffering. Have you been through some stuff? Some of you too young, you haven't been through much yet. But some of you have been through some stuff. And through it all, you know that God is God and God is good. And some of the stuff you've been through, it didn't make you bitter, it made you better. Yes. I want to tell you, amen. 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 We can say hallelujah for that.
Hallelujah.
So John had this purifying hope, this thing that kept him going in spite of what he suffered on the Isle of Patmos, because, you know, this document that we are reading was written around AD 100. But you have to remember, the Revelation was written around AD 95. So we must assume, it's reasonable to conclude, that he is writing this document after he had suffered that kind of experience that inspired the book of Revelation. Persecution. What was it that kept him going? I want to suggest just three things. You know, I have a habit of suggesting three things. But the things come right out of the scripture. These are the things that kept him going. These are the things which we call John's purifying hope. These are the things that can keep us going. These are the things that are the Christian's purifying hope. First of all, we want to point this out. He kept being amazed at the love of God. He kept being amazed at the love of God. Can we read verse 1? Verse 1 of 1 John 3. Can we read that? See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. He was amazed at the love of God. I don't know if this is news to you, but some people may not like you. That's news to you?
Amen.
No news.
But God loves you.
Amen. Amen.
I want you to think about you and all the mistakes you've made. Just think about that for a moment. We have a moment of silence. Where you're thinking about the mistakes you made, the people you disappointed. Times when your mother yelled at you. Times when your father said you're somebody else's child. You couldn't be my child. And I want to tell you this. In spite of all those mistakes, God loves you.
Yes. Amen.
Amen.
I want you to think about something else. Think about the people you don't like.
Mm-hmm. Jesus.
You have anybody like that? Think about the people you don't like. All the things that they do that irritate you. Mm-hmm. All the times when you wish they would disappear. Mm-hmm. All the times when you wish they would leave this church and find somewhere else to go. Mm-hmm. I want you to think about them. And I want to tell you this. God loves them. God loves that person.
Yes.
I want to tell you this. What kept John going is that he was so amazed at the love of God. The writer of Hymn 371 says, I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene. We just sang it. John could identify with that. And in another piece of scripture written by the same guy, John said in John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son so that everyone who believes in him may not perish but have eternal life. He kept being amazed at the love of God. And that had a kind of purifying effect on his life. The amazing love of God in Jesus continued to motivate John and make him an even better Christian. This guy had witnessed some things. He had witnessed Jesus washing his disciples' feet. He had witnessed Jesus dying on the cross. We don't have to read all of it, but we can turn to John 19 and let's read a few verses from verse 25. We'll at least stop at verse 30, but we may stop before. John chapter 19. Let's read a few verses of something that John witnessed that inspired him to keep going and getting better. And that is what the soldiers did. Meanwhile, standing near the cross were his mother and his mother's sister Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. And Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved, the same guy who wrote this document, standing beside her. He said to his mother, woman, here is your son. And he said to the disciple, here is your mother. And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own home. Let's read on a little further. After this, when Jesus knew that all was finished, he said, in order to fulfill the scripture, I am thirsty. A jar full of wine, sour wine, was standing there. So they put a sponge full of wine on a branch of hyssop and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the wine, he said, it is finished. And he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. What I'm saying is, the guy who is writing this, he saw some stuff. And he saw some stuff that inspired him to believe that God loved him. And Jesus loved him beyond measure. He saw Jesus die. And that love of Jesus had a purifying effect on his life. Well, that might seem a little distant to you. So let's talk about another contemporary example. I want you to listen carefully to this story. It's a true story that talks about love and how love can purify us. On the morning of Sunday, November 8, 1987, Irishman Gordon Wilson took his daughter Marie to a parade in the town of Enniskillen, Northern Ireland. Some of you have been there. As Wilson and his 20-year-old daughter stood beside a brick wall, waiting for English soldiers and police to come marching by, a bomb planted by IRA terrorists exploded from behind and the brick wall tumbled on them. The blast instantly killed about half a dozen people and pinned Gordon and his daughter beneath several feet of bricks. Gordon's shoulder and arm were injured. Unable to move, Gordon felt someone take hold of his hand. It was his daughter Marie. Is that you, Dad? She asked. Yes, Marie, Gordon answered. He heard several people begin screaming. Are you all right? Gordon asked his daughter. Yes, she said. But then she too began to scream as he held her hand again. And again he asked if she was all right. And each time she said yes. Finally, Marie said, Daddy, I love you very much. Daddy, I love you very much. Those were her last words. 4 hours later, she died in the hospital of severe spinal and brain injuries. Later that evening, a BBC reporter requested permission to interview Gordon Wilson. After Wilson described what had happened, the reporter asked, "How do you feel about the guys who planted the bomb?" And this was his response, and I quote, "I bear them no ill will." Wilson replied, I quote, "I bear them no grudge. Bitter talk is not going to bring Murray Wilson back to life. I shall pray tonight and every night that God will forgive them." In the months that followed, many people asked Wilson, who later became a senator in the Republic of Ireland, how he could say such a thing, how he could forgive such a monstrous act. Wilson explained, I quote, "I was hurt. I had just lost my daughter, but I wasn't angry. Marie's last words to me, words of love, had put me on a plane of love. I received God's grace through the strength of his love for me to forgive." I want you to get this picture. His daughter's love had a purifying effect on his life. For years after this tragedy, Gordon Wilson continued to work for peace in Northern Ireland. I want you to get this. His daughter's expression of love had a purifying effect on his life. I want you to remember this, especially as you feel some grudge in your heart to your unfavorite person. His daughter's expression of love had a purifying effect on his life. Love can do miracles. Just as Mary Wilson's last words to her father lifted him on the plane of love, so God's love for us lifts us onto a whole different plane, enabling us to love others no matter how they go on with their badness, no matter how much harm they may speak, or even how much harm they might have done, because you are lifted on a higher plane. God's love has a sort of purifying effect on our lives. Something that keeps us pure. Yes, God is still interested in purity. And when we contemplate the love of God, we gotta get better. Make sure that when people saying, "Those people for all these years, they're still carnal," that they're not talking about you. Make sure when they're saying, "They have not grown in years, they are still the same place they were 10 years ago," make sure that it's not you they're talking about. Because the love of Jesus should have put you on a higher plane.
Yes.
That has purified you.
Yes.
Make sure that when they're talking about vengeful and hateful people who only want to see their will done and not the will of God, that they're not talking about you. Because the love of Jesus should have put you on a higher plane. Make sure when they're talking about those people who want to control the church and do their will and not God's will, that they're not talking about you. Because the love of Jesus should have lifted you on a higher plane where you are purified and the will of God should override every other will in your life.
Yes.
Make sure that the carnal Christian that they sit down and talk about over the tea party is not you. Because you are dwelling on a higher plane. This constant amazement at the love of God kept John motivated and kept John getting better. Because the love of God is so awesome, we need not wait till we get to heaven to start living right. We can start living right here, right now. And we can start being purified here and right now. We can start doing our best for God right here and right now. So when they're talking about all those who will only participate if they have something to get out of it, make sure it's not you. Because you're on a higher plane. The love of God has a purifying effect on our lives. But here is something else that kept John going and that kept him getting better and that keeps us going and keeps us getting better. Here it is. He appreciated his position as a child of God.
Yes.
This was purifying in his life as well. He appreciated his position as a child of God. Let's read 1 John chapter 3 verses 1 and 2 again. Let's just read those two verses again. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children. No! What we will be has not yet been revealed. What we know is this. Here's the hope. When he is revealed, we will be like him. For we shall see him as he is. He appreciated his position as a child of God. I want you to think about the mother-child relationship or the father child relationship or the parent-child relationship. You know, it's a most amazing relationship. Don't mess with that relationship at all. You know, you will take a lot of stuff from people, but you see, if they do it to your child, it's a different story altogether. You're going to change from angel to demon if they mess with your kid. There are places and extent to which you are prepared to go for your child that you wouldn't do for yourself. Well, I want us to get this picture. You see, the child who appreciates that kind of relationship is going to be a better child, you know. That child is not going to get into any mess. You know why? She knows her mother will go to jail for her. And she doesn't want to see her mother in jail. He knows the extent to which his father will go for him. And therefore, he's not going to get himself in a position, if he's wise, he is not going to get himself in a position that is going to jeopardize his father's well-being. So, his father's love has a kind of purifying effect on his life. It makes him a better person. Are you getting the picture?
Yes.
Sinners are made into sons and daughters. That is an amazing truth. We talk about it. We sing about it. But do we really believe it? And do we appreciate it? Well, here are some truths about that which blew John's mind. Think about it. A simple fisherman became a son of God. Amazing. A simple fisherman became an author of books detailing eternal truths. Amazing. We know that the gospel of John was written by him. And we know that the revelation was written by him, same author. And we know that at least 1 John was written by him, although I think 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John were also written by him. But you know, biblical scholarship is an intense discussion. And there are scholars who believe that the 2nd and 3rd John was probably written by somebody else because the author of those books identify himself as John the Elder. And they draw a distinction between John the Elder and John the Apostle. If you're interested in my opinion, not that my opinion matters that much, I think the same guy wrote all the books. Because my name is Hugh Hamilton, it's the favorite song to me in any language. Reverend Hamilton, Reverend is a title the church gave to me. If they want to take it back, they could take it back. Doctor is a title that the university gave to me. If tomorrow they had gone to jail, they could take it back. But my mother gave me the name Hugh. Nobody can touch that. Call me Hugh, I'm not offended. It's the first name that I knew myself by, and it's the sweetest song to me in any language. But the point I'm making is this. I may very well, writing a document, talk about myself as Hugh. And I may very well later write a second document and speak about myself as Hugh Hamilton the Elder. Because my title in the New York Annual Conference is Elder. It doesn't mean it's a different person. It could simply mean that I included my title in the second document. Oh, boring stuff. I'm only giving you my idea about why I think that there's no difference in the authors. That John most likely wrote 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John. And the amazing thing to him is that he was a simple fisherman. And he was now a child of God. And he points out that sonship causes conflict with the world. But yet, he was confident of this. Christ is with him always, even unto the end of the age. He pointed out that Christians would be misunderstood and rejected. He knew that. Because he said, listen, you're at conflict with the world. Here are some other places, or here's at least one place where he points out that kind of conflict. We'll read a few verses, not all of it. John 15, between 18 and 27. Let's read a few verses from there. If the world hates you, be aware that it hated me before it hated you. If you belong to the world will love you as its own. Because you do not belong to the world, but I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. All those who want to be Miss Congeniality, read this. If you're interested in Christian discipleship, keep these words up there. All those people who want to be Mr. Popularity, put back those words up there. I'm just commenting on the text as we go along. Just remember this. Remember the word that I said to you. Servants are not greater than their master.
Yes.
If they persecuted me, they will persecute you. If they kept my word, they will keep yours also. All who want to stop doing your ministry in church because you think you've been persecuted. Listen to this. But they will do all these things to you on account of my name because they do not know him who sent me. If I had not come and spoken to them, they would not have sinned. But now they have no excuse for their sin. Whoever hates me hates my Father also. If I had not done among them the works that no one else did, they would not have sinned. But now they have seen and hated both me and my Father. It was to fulfill the word that is written, let me read that again. It was to fulfill the word that is written in their law, they hated me without a cause. When the advocate comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth, who comes from the Father, he will testify on my behalf. Just two more verses. You also are to testify because you have been with me from the very beginning. If I had not done among them the works that no one else did, they would not have sinned. But now they have seen and hated both me and my Father. Let's stop there for the time being. All those who think that coming to church is a popularity contest, that if they don't like, you're going to stop. That if people don't fall down and worship you, you're going to stop. Hear what Jesus is saying about what real discipleship is about. That if things don't please you, you're going to stop. That if the pastor don't do what I say, I'm going to leave. Hear what Jesus is saying about what real discipleship is all about and what real worship is all about. But the ultimate triumph in all of this, the ultimate triumph of the sons and the daughters of God, is that hope purifies us. The hope that we are children of God, or the fact that we are children of God, the fact that we appreciate our position as a child of God, it has a kind of purifying effect on our lives. And we live now our best, and we do now our best, because eternal life starts now. It transcends death. And it continues with God in heaven. Hear what one great preacher said to another. His name was David Bernard. He said this to Jonathan Edwards. I do not go to heaven to be advanced, but to honor God. It's not just reward he's looking for. It's not promotion he's looking for. It's not a degree, but to honor God. It is no matter where I shall be stationed in heaven, whether I have a high or low seat there, but to live and please and glorify God. My heaven is to please God and glorify God and give God all the praise all the time and to be wholly devoted to the glory of God. That kept him going and getting better. Yes. So those two things we observe kept John going and kept him getting better. Let me say the last thing I want to point out to you. Here's something else that kept him going and kept him getting better. He anticipated Christ's return when he would be like him. That is, he, John, would be like Christ. John knew the failures of this life. Like all of us, he had some regrets. All those who have no regrets today, just stand up. We want you to tell us your secret. Like all of us, he had some regrets. First John, he wrote in 1 John chapter 1 and verse 8, if we say that we have no sin, you want to complete that? The way we treat one another sometimes, we behave like we have no sin.
Yes, true. Yes, true.
Our lack of patience with one another sometimes, we behave like we have no sin.
Jesus.
Let us be just truthful with ourselves for a moment.
Truth.
And let us just remember where we were. And if we could say for a moment, remember where we were, and say, there but for the grace of God go I, how much better we will do in the community of faith. The best of us have our own struggles. Listen to one of the great heroes of the faith. And we're going to read some scripture now because I want you to see it. I want you to see it. Romans 7. We're only going to read about 7 verses, from 14 to about 21. We could read more, but let's read 14 to 21. Romans 7. Paul struggles. For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am of the flesh, sold into slavery under sin. I do not understand my own actions, for I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing I hate. Now, if I do what I do not want, I agree that the law is good. But in fact, it is no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells within me. For I know that nothing good dwells within me, that is my flesh. I can will what is right, but I cannot do it. For I do not do the good I want, but the evil I do not want is what I do. Can you identify?
Yes.
Now, if I do what I do not want, it is no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells within me. Verse 21. So, I find it to be a law that when I want to do what is good, evil lies close at hand. He's talking about his struggles. I'm not going to go through all the verses, but in verse 25, he had an echo of victory, a statement of victory. He didn't just finish there. He said, thanks be to God through Jesus Christ, who gives us the victory. Verse 25 of Romans chapter 7, I was talking about. Thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through Jesus Christ. Here is what keeps us going. Here's what keeps us going when we think about all the ways in which we have struggled, we have failed, we have come up with some regrets. Here's what keeps us going. We can all look forward to a better day. We can all look forward to a better day, the hope that purifies us. 1 Corinthians 13, verse 12. A day when the mysteries, all mysteries will be cleared up. I don't know if we can find that. 1 Corinthians chapter 13 and verse 12. For now, we see in a mirror dimly, but then we will see face to face. Now I know only in part, then I will know fully, even as I have been fully known. The mysteries are going to be cleared up in that better day. We know that we shall be changed. 1 Corinthians 15, 51 to 52. 1 Corinthians 15, listen, I will tell you a mystery. We will not all die, but we will all be changed. 52, in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. We shall be like him. We shall see him as he is. That kind of hope had such a purifying effect on John that he lived life like Christ in the present. I wonder if you get the picture. It had such a purifying effect on his life that he lived life like Christ in the present. I don't know if you can just pull those verses up that talks about, let's pull up verse 3. Verse 3 of 1 John chapter 3, let's pull that up again. 1 John 3 and verse 3, let's pull that up. And maybe you can look at 3 and 4. I know I didn't give you this. Yes. And all who have this hope in him purify themselves just as he is pure. That is, if we expose ourselves to God and if we embrace this hope, we will live as purer people. It was this kind of hope that helped John to live a pure life. Let's summarize the main points again. He knew God loved him. Point number one, he knew God loved him. He was amazed at the love of God, and that meant something to him, and that purified his life. He was amazed at the love of God. Don't just say it. This is an amazing thing. He was amazed at the love of God, and that purified his life. Point number two, he knew and he appreciated his position as a child of God, and that meant something to him, and that inspired and purified his life. It had a purifying effect on him. He knew that at Christ's return, he would be like Christ. The final point, he anticipated Christ's return, that he would be like him, and that meant something to him, and it inspired holy living. So in closing, let me ask you some stuff. What is it that inspires holy living in your life? If we are truly amazed at the love of God, and don't just say it, and if we truly appreciate our position as children of God, and don't exchange it to become children of the devil on the day we are displeased, and if we anticipate Christ's return when we shall be like him, it will have a purifying effect on our lives. And then we will give up all the bitterness because Christ has purified us. And we will give up all the hatred because Christ has purified us. There will be less people that you can't stand. Then we will give up all the narcissism where you're not doing anything unless you're the star girl or the star boy, because Christ would have purified you. And then you will give up all the self-centeredness where if it's not about you, it's a no-show, because Christ has purified you. And then you will give up all the gossip because Christ has purified you. And you will give up all the bad-mindedness because Christ has purified you. Those who have this hope purify themselves as Christ is pure. May God's love purify us so that when they're talking about those carnal Christians who are the same way 10 years ago as they are today, that they're not talking about you, because Christ has purified you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor, for those words. And if anything, we should take away that God's love is for all of us, not just us, but all sinners. And that if we can be like Christ, we will love one another. Amen. Thank you, Pastor.
I believe we should have a time of prayer. We want to give people an opportunity. There may be people today who want to say, today is the day I want to give my life to Christ. Don't look at anybody. If you want to make that surrender today, you can come to the altar and we can do a special prayer with you. Or maybe there are those who are saying, today I just want to surrender because I want to be better. Not that you're making the first time commitment today, but you just want to surrender because you want to be better. And you feel that you need some special prayers today. We're not going to be long, then you can come today too. Because you want to be better. You want to be better. And there are those today who are bitter. You are bitter.
Bitter, bitter.
But you want to be better, not bitter. You want to be better. You come. You have become the chief put-down artist. You can't say nothing but good about God. You can't say nothing good about your church. You are bitter. But you don't want to stay bitter. You want to be better. You come.
Lord God, you are awesome. And your servant John has identified things that will help us be better. And your servants have come forward because in their hearts they feel the need to make a change. We pray that your spirit will touch them in a special way, that they will feel your power, and that they will feel your grace moving through them, that your spirit will bear witness with their spirits that they are children of God, that they will leave here today with burdens lifted. They will leave here today with a sense of your sanctifying grace. They will leave here today infused by your power. They will leave here today because you have done a great transaction, making them become a child of God. They will leave here today knowing that they are not the same, but they have this hope within them which purifies them. For we pray believing in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray and say, let's say the Lord's Prayer now. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Go in peace, and may the peace of God go with you. Amen. We'll now do the sacrament of holy baptism. Or is it the offering time?
No, maybe? It's the baptism.
Yes.
Of Josiah Burnett. They went together.
She's not here yet?
He went together. He is in Sunday school.
Okay. We could probably do the offering until he comes. Okay. Let's do the offering.
So this is something that we all can participate in. Ushers, please follow the directions of the ushers for the offering. Thank you. Just want to thank you for these offerings. We ask that you bless each and every one that was able to give, and even those that did not have it, we ask you to bless them so that they will have it in the future. Dear God, use these offerings for the furtherance of your ministries here on earth, and we thank you for this day. Amen. We'll now have the baptism. And we'll all be seated.
Baptize you today, you know that? That is that news for you? Oh, we're gonna baptize you today. We hope you know.
Ready. Grace and Peace Church. This morning, well, not this morning, today, it's my privilege to present for baptism our young Josiah Burnett.
Josiah, you're the star, and you're looking like the star. Brothers and sisters in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We are incorporated into God's mighty act of salvation and given new birth through water and the Spirit. All this is God's gift offered to us without price. I'm going to address all the sponsors, that's all the godparents, as well as the parents, and you are going to respond in bold to the questions that are printed. On behalf of the whole church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin?
I do.
Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves?
I do.
Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior? Put your whole trust in His grace and promise to serve Him as your Lord in union with the church, which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races?
I do.
Will you nurture this child, Josiah, in Christ's holy church, that by your teachings and example, he may be guided to accept God's grace for himself, to profess his faith openly, and to lead a Christian life?
I do. I will.
Congregation, I have some questions for you. Will you please stand? Do you, as Christ's body, the church, reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ?
We do.
Will you nurture one another in the Christian faith and life and include this child now before you in your care?
With God's help, we will proclaim the good news and live according to the example of Christ. We will surround him with a community of love and forgiveness so that he may grow in his trust of God and be found faithful in his service to others. We will pray for him that he may be a true disciple who walks in the way that leads to life.
Let us join together in professing the Christian faith as contained in the scriptures of the Old and New Testaments. Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead.
Amen. Thanks for affirming your belief in Jesus Christ, as well as your belief in God the Father. Do you believe in the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the universal church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen. I'm going to ask, I know his name, but I want you to say it aloud for us, please. Josiah's mother to pronounce his name.
Josiah Burnett.
Is there a middle name?
Josiah Antonio Burnett.
Antonio Burnett. I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit works within you so that being born through water and the Spirit, you may be a true and faithful disciple of Jesus Christ, our Lord. And so the Lord bless you and keep you. And the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. And the Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you his peace in Jesus' name. Amen.
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 So now it is our joy to welcome our new brother in Christ together through baptism. You are incorporated by the Holy Spirit into God's new creation and made to share in Christ's royal priesthood. We are all one in Christ Jesus. With joy and thanksgiving, we welcome you as a member of the family of Christ. Members of the household of God, I commend Josiah Burnett to your love and care. Do all in your power to increase his faith, confirm his hope, and perfect him in love.
We give thanks for all that God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian love as members together with you in the body of Christ and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church. We renew our covenant faithfully to participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ.
Amen. And we have these two young ladies who have come up to show us what support is all about.
Okay.
They just came to stand with Josiah. on this important day and is showing all of us an example of how we need to just stand with one another in support of one another. God bless them. And so, the God of all grace, who has called us to eternal glory in Christ, establish you and strengthen you by the power of the Holy Spirit, that you may live in grace and peace. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Go in peace, and may the peace of God go with you. Amen. Congregation, you may be seated.
Going to ask the congregation to stand again so we can have the closing hymn, number 310, He Lives.
Oh,
so the Lord bless you and keep you. And the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. And the Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and you and you and you and you and you and give you his peace. And now may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and the love of God the Father and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest, remain, and abide with us all this day and forevermore. Amen. Please be seated for the spiritual life announcements. I have just